Jó, és ugyanúgy találkozom, hogy néhány ilyen kicsit oda lehet,
hogy hatásos. Megbeszélünk.
Nagyon köszönöm. Hálások lesznek érte.
Jó, köszönöm szépen. Egyébként még nem. Angolul mondok. Folytatjuk délelőtti ülésünket. The next speaker, professor Bálint Érdi, a professor from the Laurent de Ploss University.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, dear guest. Maybe the title is a little scaring, but the problem is a real fun. In the Department of Astronomy, we do dynamical investigations of exoplanetary systems, and what I would like to talk about today is a specific problem. The problem is, are there Trojan planets in exoplanetary systems? The question is right, because in the solar system we know several thousand examples of co-orbital motions. Around the Sun there are more than 2,000 known Trojan asteroids moving nearly on the same orbit like Jupiter, before and above approximately 60 degrees around the Lagrangian points L4 and L5. So the question is natural, are there Trojan objects in exoplanet systems? In recent years there were several studies on this problem, and there are formation theories, there are observational papers. It's interesting that there are three known exoplanet systems which are believed to be in 2-to-1 resonance, and still the radial velocity measurements could be interpreted as if the planet were in 1-to-1 resonance. And also there are several dynamical studies on this problem, and I just would like to show some dynamical studies on this problem. We can compute maps of dynamical stability. The model which we use is that we have a star, a giant planet, and a small planet, we call it Trojan planet, which can move around the Lagrangian equilibrium point L4. And we would like to know how the size of the stability region around L4 depend on the parameters of the problem. Basically, there are two main parameters. One is the mass ratio between the giant planet and the star, and the other is the eccentricity of the orbit of the giant planet. And we can compute the size of the stability region depending on these two parameters, the eccentricity and the mass parameter. What we see in this figure is the region of the stability around L4 and L5. Here, there is the orbital longitude, so the position along the orbit, and this is the semi-major axis. These two regions are the stable region, where a planet could be stable. In this part of the space, orbits are librational orbits, and there are some indications that here, outside the main two stability regions, there are horseshoe-type orbits, which could be temporarily stable. Now, we can compute this kind of figures showing the size of the stability region depending on the two basic parameters, and the question, what general feature can be discovered when one study hundreds of this kind of stability maps? A basic feature which we found is that when we fix the eccentricity of the giant planet's orbit and increase the mass ratio between the giant planet mass and the star, then we would expect that the size of the stability region would decrease, because if the mass of the planet is larger, then the perturbations are larger, and we imagine that the size of the stability region will decrease. However, for a larger mass parameter, the size of the stability region is larger, which is quite surprising. And we find it always for different eccentricities, increasing the mass parameter in this direction. For a time, the region of the size of the region decreases, and then for a larger mass parameter, we obtain a larger region. And the question, why? We found this behavior in those cases when the Trojan planet has quite big mass. In a model, when a Trojan planet had one Jupiter mass, and the giant planet also had one Jupiter mass or seven Jupiter mass, this configuration could be stable, which is surprising, but the computations show. So a mean conclusion from this kind of stability investigation, which we could conclude, is that the size of the stability region decreases non-uniformly with the increase of the mass parameter. Well, this needs an explanation, and we decided to do a more detailed stability investigations. And we did it in the last few months. We computed a stability map with a very high resolution in the mass parameter and the eccentricity. I just explain what we computed. We have the system, the star, the planet, and the Lagrangian point L4, and we fix the mass parameter and the eccentricity for some specific value, and for this pair of the parameters, we put the test planet into the Lagrange point, and we started with zero initial velocity with respect to the giant planet. And we compute what happened during 5,000 periods of the giant planet. And if the test planet stays here, then we say that the Lagrangian point is stable. And then we move a little away along this line. And we compute the same in the next point and so on, and we go until the orbit of the test planet cross the line of the primaries. So we compute the half distance of the largest Lagrangian orbits. And if we do it for many, many pairs of the mass parameter and the eccentricity, then we arrive for this figure. What can be seen in this figure? It shows that for a given mass parameter value and for a given eccentricity, that is for this point, what is the behavior of the Lagrangian point? This region, the yellow region, is the place where the Lagrangian point is unstable. If we put the test planet to the Lagrangian point for this value of the eccentricity and the mass parameter, then it will be unstable. So this is the border between the unstable and the stable region. Well, it is a difficult theoretical problem to find this boundary between the stable and unstable region. And 30 and 40 years ago, there were a lot of papers and big discussions how one could obtain this curve theoretically. Now, the novelty of this figure is that now we see in the region where the Lagrangian point L4 could be stable, that how large is the stability region around L4. Dark colors mean that, for example, for this value of the mass parameter eccentricity, we have a very big stability region, and the green color means that the stability region is smaller, and then there are the red lines, quite small. So there is some interesting distribution in the sizes of the stability regions, and this figure explains why we found in earlier investigations that property, that when we fix the eccentricity and increase the mass parameter, why we find maxima after minima. But of course, this figure needs some further explanation. What is the reason for this interesting structure? And one might suspect that these structures are connected to resonances. Resonances between the frequencies of motions. And the question is how one can compute frequencies and even resonant frequencies in the elliptic restricted three-body problem. I'll just skip these figures. Well, everybody knows who learns celestial mechanics that in the circular restricted three-body problem, that is when the planet moves around the star in a circular orbit, then librational motion along Lagrangian point L4 has two frequencies corresponding to the short periodic and long periodic librations. Almost nobody knows who learns celestial mechanics how many frequencies are in the elliptic restricted three-body problem. It turns out that instead of two, we have four frequencies, and this is because in the elliptic restricted problem, that is when the giant planet or the planet moves around the star in an elliptic orbit, then the Lagrangian point L4 has even an elliptic motion similar to the giant planet's motion, and it has a frequency, and this frequency denoted by n combines with the other two frequencies, and in this way we have four frequencies. I just show it in this figure. The frequencies depend on the mass parameter, and this figure shows how the four frequencies depend on the mass parameter. So there is one frequency, there is another frequency, and these two frequencies meet for this value of the mass parameter, which is about 0.04. There are two other curves, frequency curves, and these also meet here, cross here. These two frequency curves meet in another point. Well, this cross point and these meeting points, A, B, C, are points where the frequencies are equal, and these are corresponds, this corresponds to one-to-one resonances. Well, now, the question how one can compute the frequencies in the elliptic restricted three-body problem. When I was thinking about that problem, I remembered back a paper which I had read more than 30 years ago, but it was forgotten because at the time they could not solve this equation. It was derived by Rabe, who was a very big name at that time, and this equation relates the three parameters which is important in the problem, the frequency, the mass parameter, and the eccentricity. It looks horrendous. It's 20th order in the frequency, 5th order in the mass parameter, and 4th order in the eccentricity. Well, horrendous does it look, but it has a simple structure. It is 4th order in the eccentricity, which can be reduced to 2nd order, which is very important in the process of the solution. Rabe himself used this equation for a 4th order stability analysis of Lagrangian point L4. This equation has four roots for the frequency between 0 and 1. When the frequency is 1, it corresponds to the frequency of the giant planet. Rabe himself found two solutions for this equation, which he derived. One solution corresponds to this cross point, the other solution corresponds to this meeting point. These two points are critical points, and these are critical frequencies, because these define, in the mass parameter eccentricity plane, the boundary between the between stable and unstable region. Well, Rabe derived from the point solution an approximate analytical solution for the equation corresponding to this point, and if we draw the solution corresponding to Rabe's solution, then we find this curve. You see, it fits very well. So there is one-to-one resonance along this curve between two frequencies. And moreover, there is a 2-to-1 resonance also, which is quite interesting that at the same time there are two resonances. Well, Rabe found an approximate analytical solution for this point, starting from this point also. This is fourth order index entity. I forgot to mention that the previous solution was third order. Now, what happened when we put this figure on our computations? Oh, there is some problem. I don't see if you can see. Maybe you can you see? So this curve, rather second solution, comes here. They should meet here, but not. It's a problem. Now, Rabe knew this, and he wrote in his paper, considering the terms up to and including third-order terms in the eccentricity, in both solutions, it is found that the two boundaries come together. What does it mean? It means that if from the second solution we leave out the fourth-order term, then the two solutions come together. Let's see. Yes. They come together here, and Rabe is proud that this cross point is nearly the same which was predicted theoretically. Well, but of course, one does not satisfy with this. And I remembered also an old paper, 36 years ago, that Chauner derived an exact analytical solution for that boundary. There is an exact analytical solution for this. Chauner's paper is interesting because in this paper he did several very good things and did a few bad things. Fortunately, one of the best things which he did is that he found an exact analytical solution for that boundary curve, and using that boundary curve, we were able to derive correctly the fourth order terms in Rabe's second solution. And if we put the corrected curve here, then we find that the two curves meet here, which was expected and we wanted to do. I think I went to the wrong direction. Oh, this is a good direction. Well, I must correct myself. When we put the right solution here, what happens that this curve matches very well the boundary, but departs from Rabe's first solution. There is a gap here, which needs that we should correct this. However, it cannot be corrected by using the enormous equation because of the structure of the equation. What we could do is that we determined for this solution numerically a fourth order term. This is the would necessary, and if we put the corrected solution, then we have a more matching solution, and the two curves cross exactly here where they should. Well, these are the boundaries, but what is the situation with this part? And now we wanted to compute resonance solutions. What kind of resonances are possible between the frequencies? This figure tells us four curves of the frequencies, and from the four frequencies we have to choose pairs. From the four frequencies we can form six pairs of the frequencies. These two frequencies could be in resonance, or these two frequencies, and so on. There are six possibilities. What is a resonance? I forgot to mention, hoping that everyone knows, when two frequencies have rational ratio. Okay. Now, how we could solve the innermost Bragg equation for resonant frequencies. It is very simple when one knows the solution. If there are two frequencies in resonance, Z, the other is RZ, where R is the ratio of the resonance. For example, this is 0.6, and this is 0.2, then there is a 3-to-1 resonance. For a given mass parameter, we have two equations, one for the one frequency and the other for the resonant frequency. Now, we solve these two equations for the eccentricity, and because it can be reduced to second order, can express the solution properly, and the solution depends on the frequency, and what we have to do all is that we equate the two eccentricity and look for that value of the frequency when the two solution equation. In this way, for a given kappa, we can solve the frequency and eccentricity, and repeating it for several kappa, we obtain a curve along this, there is the resonance, so we obtain a resonant curve. And this is what we obtained. These are curves of different resonances, and they fit very well to the minimum places in the size distribution of the stability region. The solution is valid about 0.3 in the eccentricity because Rabe's equation is fourth order in the eccentricity. So for higher values of the eccentricity, the solution departs from the real situation. One could go to higher order, but it is very difficult. Rabe's equation comes from an infinite determinant corresponding to infinite linear equations for the coefficients of periodic solutions around L4. There are a lot of interesting things with this resonant solution. I just mentioned one. There are two resonant curves here, which cross each other here, and from their cross point, a third resonant curve goes exactly through. So at this point, there are a triple resonance, and there is a Laplace-type resonance between the frequencies. Laplace-type resonance, we know the Galilean satellites of Jupiter have a Laplace-type resonance. Well, that was a simple model where we define stability in a very simple way. When we make more realistic computations, we have this kind of structure. This figure also shows the size distribution of the stability region. Here, for small mass parameters and for small eccentricity, there is a large region of stability around L4. Here, there are no stability regions at all. And we can see here minimum places, which nothing else but the resonant places. What kind of conclusion could be drawn from this result with respect to exoplanetary systems? Maybe that when we look for the possibility, if there are Trojan planets, then the probability of their occurrence depend on the parameters of the system. And there are certain mass parameter values for which there are resonances, and when there are resonances, then the region of stability is small, so the chance that a Trojan planet exists is smaller. Future works. There are plenty of ideas. I'll just show one. Can you see? And can you see this? How one can obtain without a larger equation? By numerical fitting, which is a possibility. We know the solution for this part, and by continuation of this solution, we can obtain these resonant curves. The only drawback of this kind of solution is that we cannot compute the frequencies here, which is a problem still to be solved, and I think I stop at this point. Just farewell. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Ildi. But before the questions, I have a remark. I observed that Palintedi used the possibility to speak to the remote station also. This talk was not for us, but several times. You have been spoken to the auditorium somewhere far away. It was very nice. Please, some questions.
We have seen how good, if we could remember our papers written 30 years ago, yes. We have good memory.
Professor Sada used to say, there is nothing new in celestial mechanics, just one does not know well old papers.
Another question, do you know any real planetary system that fits in your problem? I mean, a giant planet and a smaller one.
Well, I mentioned the possibility that there are three exoplanetary systems having two planets, and the radio velocity measurements can be consistent with one-to-one resonance as well. Not two-to-one, but one-to-one.
Thank you very much.